Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and I'm so glad you joined me today because we have Tom Lewis here, who is the founder, owner, and CEO of T.W. Lewis Company, which is based here in Arizona. But he's known for so many other things as well, including his latest book, Solid Ground, A Foundation for Winning in Work and in Life. It's packed full with so much information about values and how to succeed in business. This is going to be really fascinating to talk to Tom. So we're going to do that, and we're going to do that right after this.
Are you interested in finding out more about how HR professionals or leadership consultants can become certified to give the groundbreaking new Curiosity Code Index assessment? The certification program will provide the ability to administer the assessment at reduced rates. Participants will learn how to interpret the results of the CCI, as well as how to deliver an innovation plan workshop designed to improve curiosity, engagement, innovation, and productivity. To find out more, go to curiositycode.com.
I am here with Tom Lewis, also known as T.W. Lewis, who is the founder of T.W. Lewis Company, an award-winning Scottsdale, Arizona-based real estate and investment company known for its quality and outstanding customer service in the home building industry. He has received a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Professional Builder magazine and was the first inductee into the National Housing Quality Hall of Fame. He has done a lot of different work in philanthropy. We're going to get into some of that. I'm interested in his latest work, which is a book he's titled Solid Ground, A Foundation for Winning in Work and in Life. And I can't imagine anybody who knows how to do that better than Tom Lewis. So it's so nice to have you on the show, Tom.
Well, great to be with you, Diane. Thank you.
Oh, well, I was looking forward to this. As I had told you off the air, you and I met sort of many years ago because our kids have gone to school together. So this is fun that we get to actually meet in a different realm. You're quite a famous person here in Arizona, as it is, because T.W. Lewis does very well here. And I want to get a little bit of background on you, of what led to your interest in just, you know, going into the real estate business and home building industry and all of that. So can you just give me your background a little bit?
Yeah, sure. Well, you know, in this book that I just have written, I really get into the details of that. But to make a short story out of it, I got my master's in business from the University of North Carolina in 1973. My undergraduate degree in mechanical engineering from Kentucky, which is where I'm from. And then I had four different jobs over a period of 18 years in the real estate business. And in each job, I worked for, obviously different people. I was lucky to have some really great executives to become role models for me. And I, over that period of 18 years, I probably had eight different bosses, lived in six different states, and probably had 20 different jobs.
Wow.
And the point of all that in my book is really to show the progression of learning and development because, you know, when you graduate from high school, you know so little, certainly when you look back on that. And then even when you graduate from college, you know, you just don't know anything about the real world and you have to learn that yourself. And so the way you learn that is you watch other people and then you try hard things. And the more difficult things you take on, the more adversity you encounter, the more resilience you build. And then you just keep repeating that cycle. And after about 10 or 20 years, you become pretty smart and pretty resilient. And you begin to figure out who you are and what you're good at. And then, so that was the progression that I took over those 18 years. And then, about halfway through that period, I got a job offer in Phoenix, Arizona, to come out and work for a home building company. And that had been the industry I was already in. And so I came here and continued that and then ended up joining Trammell Crow Company in 1990, 1984, actually, and became a partner there. And that allowed me to begin to build my net worth as an individual and as an investor. And then I had the opportunity in 1991 to start my own company. And so I did that, and we called it T.W. Lewis Company. But what I had learned in the home building business for 18 years was that all the home builders really cared about was quantity. And I was a small company. I was going to compete with over 30 large public home builders in Phoenix back in those days. And so I had to stand out and be different. And the way I figured out I could be different and still be myself was to focus on quality, not quantity. And so I built T.W. Lewis Company as a small kind of a boutique high-end home builder that was doing something no other home builder was doing. And it took us a while to really get it figured out and to get our systems to where they were really achieving what we wanted. But ultimately, we were named America's Best Builder and won the National Housing Gold Award for quality and made a lot of customers really happy. So,
well, you definitely have always gotten very positive press, everything I've ever seen in Arizona. I mean, it's a name you can't miss. And I know you do a lot. And I saw you had done, had been in Kentucky. My husband did his surgical residency there. And I was looking at a lot of the philanthropy. You do so many different things that I was just drawn to. In your website, I told you a little before we got on the air, I was looking at some of the quotes. I love the quote part of your website. You give some of the words, I think you call it words for wisdom section. I was trying to figure out where curiosity fits into that, just because that's what I'm interested in. And because I think that a lot of the things you focus on for good leadership and success are the things I focus on. And you talk about, you have a category of self-awareness, and I know you have a chapter that focuses on self-awareness. And I that's a big part of emotional intelligence. And I'm wondering how you got interested in these certain qualities and what stories or what led you to these particular foundations of success?
Yeah, well, when I was in graduate business school, there was a professor there named Dr. Jerry Bell, and he was 28 years old at the time, and I'd just come out of engineering school, and so I did a 4.5-year program in 4 years, and so I never really took any electives, and so I had no background at all in psychology or anything like that. But in this grad school course, this professor had just written a book called The Achievers, where he identified five different categories of people. And I'll never forget what they are. They were the achiever, the commander, the avoider, the attacker, the manipulator, and the pleaser. Actually, that's six different personalities. Okay.
Which one are you?
I'm the achiever.
I think I am too. Okay.
And so, but that was the first time I'd ever heard that concept, that people can actually be put into boxes. And we all know that we're all much more complicated than six.
Six.
But in at that time in my life, I'm 22 years old, I was blown away by that. And it's like, wow, that explains so much. And I started thinking about all the people I knew and who was what. And so that got me started on a lifelong kind of passion for personality types. And then as I got into my career, some of the companies I worked for had me take assessments, and they told me things about myself that I'd never considered and accepted. And then I started taking the tests, like the Myers-Briggs and the DISC and the values courses. And then I actually used a handwriting analyst one time in a recruiting job and handwriting analysis is really fascinating.
Isn't it?
It really is. And it tells, so there's things there too, but the point is though, that we all, and when I say self-awareness, that's, talking about all those things, and we're all very complicated, and we do change some, but not a whole lot. And but the thing that I talk about in the book, but I want young people to understand this as they go through their careers, because, for example, I'll we have three sons, and they're all great young men, but they're, of course, they're different personalities. And the first one is in business, is an operator. He's the kind of person that just likes operations. He's a manager. The second one is a finance person. He's always been drawn to finance. And the third one is a salesperson, a natural salesperson, just a persuasive, take charge sales guy. And so, you know, each of my sons kind of exhibits those three different kind of business, profiles.
Right.
But what I learned in my career, as I look back, is it really is the values you're in that determine your success and how well you can align your career with what I'll call your motivating values. And there's two different types of values. There's the what I call core values. And I've in the book, I've listed 100 possible core values. They're everything from honesty to integrity to humility to perseverance to, there's kindness. I listed 100, and I have a little quiz in there to take. But so those are what I call core values. And the trick there is to come up with your top six. And when I started T.W. Lewis Company, I knew what my top six core values were, and they were honesty, integrity, hard work, reliability, compassion, and achievement. And those six values I put up on the wall in the lobby of my company on a board and declared that those were our company's values. And that was an important thing to say to my employees, because it let them know how I expected them to behave and how I expected them to treat others and, each other, our other employees, and especially our customers. And so that became, those became the rules of behavior in our company. And they were also reminders, and we even put them on the back of our business card, because, we wanted the world to know this is what we stand for. And if we say we're going to be honest, we're honest. And if we say we're going to do what we say we're going to do, we do that. And then for a home builder, I wanted to be reliable, and I am reliable. I always have been. And but wouldn't you like to buy a home from a home builder that was reliable?
Yeah. kind of important.
Yeah. Yeah. So I thought it was also kind of a competitive issue as well.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I was wondering. You said there's two values: core values, and is there the other category?
Yes, I was on there. The second category is really the most important, and that's called motivating values.
Okay.
And that is in the DISC format. The DISC is the dominance, influencing, steadiness, compliance. That's the behaviors, and those are how we behave. But what really motivates us is something different. And the DISC has six different motivating values, and I believe I can recite those too. They're theoretical, aesthetic, utilitarian, traditional. I'll think of the other ones in a minute.
I should know. I always think of the other four, but when you get down to it, the other what motivates us personally. I'm curious what your DISC type is. Are you a high D?
You bet.
So am I. Okay, now that we got that, what's your Myers-Briggs? I'm curious.
Okay, well, I'm right on the border between E and I. I'm kind of a 5 on that. I'm pretty close to the middle of S and N too, sensing and intuition. But a total T.
That's fine.
And a total J.
You're kind of very similar to what I am. I'm an ESTJ, and with the T, I had zero F. I mean, it was completely T.
you know me too. I was a zero.
I've never heard of another to zero. Well, it's nice to meet you. And
I'm a zero.
And I am so on time that the J thing, that wasn't even a question. But
I didn't even like to hire people that were not J's and not T's. The only time I would hire an F was in sales.
Yeah. Well, you know, yeah.
Because in the home building business, you got to make decisions with your head. I mean, it is not a soft industry, you know.
Yeah. Well, you know, I was in sales for decades, and you mentioned your kids were in sales. Was it your youngest that who went into sales, or your oldest? I'm always curious.
Yeah, our youngest.
Your youngest. You know, my youngest went into sales, who I think knows your youngest, and she and I wrote a book together many years ago about all the different personality assessments, like DISC and emotional intelligence and all these things that we're talking about, which is such a small world. But
so let me go back to these
motivating. Yeah.
So these, it took me a minute to kind of look
those
up.
Yeah, I was just giving you some time to find them. Okay.
So there's six of them.
Okay.
That's a person that values knowledge for knowledge's sake. Utilitarian, someone who appreciates efficiency and return on investment. Aesthetic, values beauty and creativity. Social, that's the social value that cares about other people. And then there's individualistic, which is kind of the ego-driven person. But it's also the makes you want to get better, to improve so that you can compete and win.
Uh-oh.
Okay. The individual.
I myself.
Yeah. I could tell that from your website.
Is that what you are?
Huh?
Are you that?
Well, so my top one is utilitarian and number two is individualistic. So, uh-huh. but those are known, you know, oddly, those used to be called the utilitarian value used to be called the wealth value. And the individualistic value used to be called the power value. But the words power and wealth are no longer popular.
How do they describe utilitarian again?
Utilitarian is someone that cares about efficiency.
Oh, I'm big on that then.
And likes, and also return on investment. And not only return on your money, but return on your time.
Yeah.
Utilitarians don't like to waste time.
I don't at all. That's okay. Funny how much you and I have the same personality qualities and things.
But the point, though, is that so my strongest values, and I didn't learn this till I was probably in my 40s, were utilitarian and individualistic, or those are my top two. Well, that explains my success as a home builder, really. I mean, that plus a lot of other things. But, boy, had I not had those are the two things that got me up every morning and made going to work fun and exciting and competitive. And I was trying to build a company to be recognized and to make money and to do all the good things that you can do with a company. But when I realized that I had found a job and a career that aligned with my values, I thought, bingo, that's the secret sauce right there. You know?
Right. Well, I'm just thinking how many of those qualities I think are so important. I've had a lot of people on the show like Tom Hopkins, and I work on boards with Harvey McKay, and some of the people you probably have had to run across, course, in your time. And I think, you know, you're drawn to these sales competitive kind of businesses if you have these certain qualities. That's why I always think it's really fascinating to learn more about personality types. And I think that, as you said, some of them don't change. Myers-Briggs, they always said, you know, it stays the same throughout your life. And a lot of these don't unless you have these major traumas. But I think to recognize what we're good at, and I know Tom Rath was on the show who wrote Strengths Finders, you know, and I'm curious how you look at this. Do you develop your area, do you do kind of like a personal SWAT and develop in the areas where you're not strong, or do you focus more on your strengths?
You totally focus on your strengths. That's my philosophy. You forget weaknesses. You know, somebody asked me, I was doing another interview, and they asked me how I felt about learning how to play the piano. And I said, I think that would be a complete waste of time for me. Okay. And he laughed and he goes, why do you say that? And I said, because I'm not an aesthetic. You know, music is just, I mean, I like to listen to music, but that's not something I'm particularly good at, and I would be a huge failure at it. And it's not fun to do things you're not good at. So why would I be interested in playing the piano? I would rather learn other skills that kind of fit my value structure.
What skills do you work on that you think would be good to work on then? Or what, you know, what talents do you try to pick up if not taking the piano or learning guitar or singing or that type of thing?
Well, you know, I mean, for me, I was always focused on very few things, especially, you know, I was always in a hurry to accomplish, you know, my beginnings were humble. My dad was a military officer, but filed bankruptcy when I was in high school, and he had started a business and failed. And so I kind of was driven by that, but I was in a hurry to succeed. And I was focused on really two things, building a company and building a family. And so I had plenty of fun. I played golf. I had lots of friends and I exercised a lot, but I didn't go out and try to, find my passion of something that I like, playing a piano or collecting stamps or something like that. I was too serious about life and about success. And so the more, and there's a chapter in my book called Hard Work. And today a lot of, one of the things in my book I'm trying to do is to dispel the many popular myths that exist out there that actually undermine people's success. And just to mention, one of those myths is 30 is the new 20 and work smarter, not harder.
Yeah.
You know? So that's just an excuse to not work very hard and wait till you're 30 to get serious. Okay. Well, those are completely stupid things. And had I done, but the point is, though, when you start working hard and you start working early, you start learning lots and lots of lessons that other people, that you can only learn through hard work. And then while you're doing that, you're again encountering adversity, building confidence and building resilience. And there's a saying by a Kentucky basketball coach that I love that, hard work leads to competence. Competence leads to confidence, and it takes confidence to succeed. It all starts with hard work. So how do you become competent? You put in the time, and you work on something you're already good at. Like Michael Jordan, people watching his show now, that's a classic, classic story of hard work and competence and talent.
He obviously is a very impressive example of that. And I'm curious where curiosity falls with you. Have you always been curious about specific things? Do you think curiosity should be encouraged in the workplace? Just your insights on that would be interesting to me.
Okay, well, I have a little bit different take on curiosity. And, in our philanthropy, we have done a lot with public universities and
ASU too, right?
And Kentucky and North University of Carolina. And I have a lot of good friends and people that I work with regularly that are in the university community. And I notice they talk a lot about curiosity, but here's my assumption, and you tell me, because you would have another insight. But I think if you have a high theoretical value, and the definition of that is valuing knowledge for knowledge's sake, you then have a high opinion of the concept of curiosity.
Okay? Right.
Now, again, my wife and I had a scholarship program for 16 years where she and I would interview students individually for an hour, and we would do about 40 every spring each. Hmm. And so, I loved doing it. It was just so much to talk to these sharp high school kids that had a financial need and wanted to go to great schools. So I found a lot of them would really talk a lot about curiosity. And of course they were the 4.0 superstar students. But as I learned later, they all also had high theoretical values, which meant they believed that knowledge was a great thing for its own, and was its own reward. And so for me, I'm not a high theoretical value person. I don't have that. My theoretical value is not that high. So to me, I don't really want to learn something unless I can do something with it, unless it's useful, So, now there's obviously exceptions to that. But in general, I don't go around thinking, well, what am I curious about and what do I want to learn for the sake of knowing so I can talk about it at cocktail parties? You know,
yeah.
not interested. You know, yeah. I want.
Yeah, I think it's interesting to look at it from the getting away from status quo, doing the same way of doing business kind of curiosity. You know what I mean? Like, questions are good to ask in meetings. If everybody's in agreement, are you going to get the next great innovative idea kind of curiosity?
Yeah, okay, that's a different kind of curiosity.
That's more what I deal with. But I there's, you know, curiosity is such a commonly used word that in the business setting, I think I'm dealing with, you know, like how, if you've ever read Mindset by Carol Dweck, you know, you can have a fixed or a closed mindset to things.
Right.
And there's a lot of research behind curiosity in general. But I think what you're saying is, you know, a lot of people do value knowledge for knowledge's sake. And I think in the leadership realm, sometimes we've inadvertently shut people down on their ideas because we leave a meeting, everybody's in agreement, and then really everybody's afraid to speak up. Or, you know, did you see a lot of that in the business world?
Well, you know, I'm thinking about a book that Jack Welch wrote years ago. I believe he called it Winning.
Right.
But in as I remember in that book, he talked about how powerful candor was.
Right.
Just and then how rare it was. And I can attest to that.
Yeah.
And I mean, really kind of calling it out when people are talking, you know, when something needs to be said, saying it. And that, I'm not sure if that's curiosity or not. That's more candor, I guess. But
I think it falls into what I talk about, though, you know, and I think that it's really important. And my last boss, you know, worked with Jack, and I've had a lot of people on the show talk about Jack who have worked with him, actually just yesterday, which is funny. But he has, I think you're touching on a lot of words that I find curiosity based, because in your chapter titles, you finding success, finding purpose. That means seeking. Mm-hmm. Questioning, you know, to me. Do you look at it that way?
Well, you know, here's the way I look at it. Because I'm a high D, I'm focused on problems.
Right.
Okay? So what drives me behaviorally is solving a problem. You know, and to a high D like yourself or like me, if you present us with a problem, we can't sleep until we solve that.
You know, nope.
I've had to tell my wife a lot, please don't present me with any problems
after
when we're
6
going.
P.M. Right.
Yeah, because I just can't turn my brain off, you know. So,
nope.
So, the curiosity that I have is problem solving. Is how do I solve that problem?
Right.
You know.
Right. Well, I think that's why you've been so successful, though. You know, you value these really high, you know, areas of success that a lot of people. And you write it down and you focus on sharing it. And I think that's what I see as a problem in a lot of organizations is, you know, the culture comes from the top. And I've worked here in town in the past in sales. I even worked at local Keller Williams and different things after I was in pharmaceutical sales and all these other things. And I remember at Keller Williams, they actually did put like their value statement on the wall. And I've worked in other companies that made me read their value statements for a video and if I had to memorize it word for word. And I think that it's good to know why what we do in our jobs ties into the overall goals that the organization has. And I don't think a lot of organizations share like what you do. Where did you learn to do that?
Learn to do what?
To share your values, to make it be on the business cards, to do all the things you do, to share what means, what's important to you.
Well, okay. Good question. When I started my own company, I had worked for 4 different companies. Okay, mm-hmm. So I had been an employee for 4 different companies. None of them did that. Okay, none of them did that. Now, the fourth company I worked for, I think their values were pretty clear, except they didn't talk about them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they didn't write them down, and people didn't used to do that. But the values were very strong and were very clear, I thought, and very good, by the way. I mean, I think their values were success and partnership and integrity. And those were just embedded in all the key leaders. And so that was the message we got. But then the company I worked for before that had no vision at all and had lots of employees and was growing really fast. and just never, you never knew what the heck we stood for. We,
that's frustrating, you know, yeah.
And it was so frustrating as an employee to work for a company that the truth of the matter was, if they had a vision statement, it would be XYZ company exists in order to make their owners as rich as possible, as fast as possible. I mean that that was the true underlying vision.
Or get out. Yeah.
And so and I thought, just what a terrible way to operate. I can do better than that. So that's why when I started my company, I knew I could not fail. And I wanted my employees to know what we stood for. And so we came up with a vision statement that was at the top of this plaque in our lobby. And I will never forget it. It was probably the smartest thing I ever did. And the vision statement went like this. And we were just getting started. Okay. T.W. Lewis Company will become the best home building organization in America as measured by product quality, customer satisfaction, and profitability.
Ooh, I love how specific that is.
You know, and that, like I said, that's probably the smartest thing I ever did.
Yeah.
In business. And so, but that made it clear to my employees what we stood for. And then I added those six values. It's like, okay, now we're working for a company that knows what it wants to do and how to do it. And now we know what we stand for and how we stand out. And it, we were able to attract people that were drawn to that vision and those metrics, and they aren't, you know, we had some great employees for a long, long time. So,
well, you know, I want to touch on some of the stuff that this ties into, because you wrote a whole part of your book on reaching your potential. And I think that the very first part of that, it fascinates me, because you talk about finding your talent. Mm-hmm. And this is all kinds of things that I talk to organizations about. And I want to know your insight on finding your talent. What do you mean by your talent, and how do we find it?
Okay. well, there's a man here. Have you ever heard of Target Training International?
I don't know. I got to think about that one. I don't think so.
They're an assessment company, and they're actually based here in Phoenix. They're one of the largest assessment companies in the country, and they do a lot of the DISC things. Mm-hmm. And so Bill Bonstetter was the founder of that company.
Oh, yeah. I heard of him.
Mm-hmm. And he and I were friends, and he really was the one that kind of explained to me what talent is. And talent is a combination of several different things. I'm trying to find it here right now. It's in the book.
I just wondered your own version of what you think are the, like, talents. I mean, I know you talked about in the book, like, behaviors, motivators, like about these seven different dimensions, you know, and you listed emotional intelligence. So mm-hmm. do you look at that as a talent? How do you look at that? As a trait or a...
Okay, so you're right. What I have in the book is kind of the seven theoretical mm-hmm. components of talent.
Uh-huh.
But to me, I would say, you know, what are you naturally good at with little or no effort?
Okay.
Ask your parents.
What comes naturally to you?
Ask your friends. You know, what would people pay you to do for them that you're just really good at? And I think if you ask people that know you well, everybody has a talent. You know, you're really good with tools, or you're really good with pulling concepts out of complicated documents. That's your talent. Now, it's also includes, though, your motivating values and your behaviors, because that's your natural style and way of being. And so, but then you have to work on it. You know, and the example I'll use again is Michael Jordan. He was, you know, grew to be 6'6", fast and quick. But, you know, he was cut from his junior high basketball team because he wasn't any good at basketball when he was 14. Okay.
Uh-huh.
So he was not born to be a great basketball player. He just had the talent, the innate talent to go. And then you take the talent, and now you have to add the hard work.
Right.
And the effort and the drive and the
resilience
that comes from that. And so talent is just one, and the book I demonstrate a pyramid that has 15 different qualities in it that all build to success and happiness, and it starts
like
with
Maslow's. You kind of got like a scaffolding. You reach one level and it builds to the next.
Exactly, uh-huh. And you know, and so I noticed in looking at your book on cracking curiosity code, you're talking about how someone can overcome the factors that are holding them back to right. achieving their potential. And what I've seen in my world, my life, is so many people are held back by their habits. It's not their lack of curiosity or their lack of talent, but it's their lack of habits. And so
I want to touch on that. Habits are sometimes reinforced by what we tell ourselves, don't you think? If we say, really? I'm not going to be good at that, or I didn't like that in the past, or that guy was mean, he's just going to give me more work. Do you think that this is reinforced by that voice in our head?
Absolutely, mm-hmm. But I'll tell you how to get that voice out of your head.
Okay, I'd love to hear that.
go to work.
Is what?
I mean, is go to work. Because, you know, if you're having self-doubts, and really, you know, there's so many great things that happen when you work hard. And uh-huh. But one of those things is self-esteem. And I tell a story in my book when I was in high school. In the summer, I had a job as as the jackhammer guy on a pipeline crew. And all day, every day, I had a jackhammer in my hand busting out rocks. And that's a ridiculously hard job. And every night I would just, you know, I could hardly sleep. My arms were stiff and all that. But after doing that for several months, you know, I just thought, wow, you know, I don't think anybody has a harder job than me. This, and I felt good about myself. And I think it built my self-esteem, you know? Mm-hmm. So when you work hard and you really put all you've got into something, you do something that is esteemable, and that's how you build your esteem. You can't get esteem any other way. And then the other two great things that happen are adversity. You encounter adversity, you learn to deal with it and accept it and suck it up. And then the third thing, uh-huh. and it comes to resilience, uh-huh. that you're not afraid. And so once you've done that, you know, hundreds of times, your self-esteem has risen a lot. And you are, and you feel like you deserve victory.
Well, you know, I'm thinking as you're telling me this of somebody I managed once who was the exact opposite of us. And, you know, if I give this person even any like simplistic thing to do, emotional tears, sobbing, it's too hard. And then by the time you'd be off the phone, the task would be done. She's very capable. How do you manage somebody? Would that person not fit into your values and get into the company to begin with? Or do you have advice for leaders who have people who maybe don't suck it up? They have a more emotional kind of personality.
But you said this person was emotional, but then they got it done immediately.
They would get it done, but make you miserable in the process through.
Well, I would keep them. I would keep them.
As long as they got it done, right?
I would find a way to like them. Yeah. I mean, that would be a keeper right there. You know,
how do you get them to have that suck it up quality, I guess?
Well, you can't, and that's the point. I can't make anybody else have that attitude. That has to come from within. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, a good coach, I was a high school athlete, primarily football, but I had some great high school coaches, and that's what they do with young men, you know, and with women today, is to kind of help kids learn to suck it up, you know, mm-hmm. and that's what there's a part in my book that says football prepared me for life, because all the things you have to do as a high school football player are the things you do when you become a grown up, which really is kind of sucking it up. It's just doing what you have to do. Getting knocked down, getting back up, getting knocked down again.
Right.
And so you have to learn that's how life is, and there's nothing wrong with that. But today I worry that we're teaching our children so much about being safe and about not getting hurt and about wearing helmets on tricycles and things like that, that we're teaching them that they're fragile, actually. And that's the big knock on universities today, is they're continuing that behavior with hate speech. And, you can be hurt not only by a fist, but you can also be hurt by words that make you cry, Mm-hmm. So that's just setting you up for failure, because it tells you you're fragile and you're weak and you can't, and you have no resilience. And then at the same time, they're offering resilience classes. So
it is a different time. I mean, our kids went to the same middle school, and I'm thinking back to the PE and things that they taught at our kids' age, and what I had to go through when you're freezing outside running laps and they're inside with little ropes and balls and having fun. Do you think that each year, how much resilience and sucking it up quality do you think we used to have, because you had to play out in the dirt with a stick, you had jacks and a ball, and that was about it,
Well, yeah, I think there's a lot of that. And, and our parents even had more, because they grew up in even rougher circumstances. But as we get more developed as a country, and now everybody's on computers all day long, and there's really not a lot of physical labor that takes place. And so it's a different world, But the concepts of hard work and resilience still remain. And that's why I call it doing hard things.
Yeah.
I mean, for me to do a jackhammer all day long, that was a hard thing. To run an 800 meter race, that's a hard thing. But it's also a hard thing to pick up a work assignment and write a paper, or to put together a comprehensive analysis of something, And so that's hard work too. And so I think the principles are still the same.
I like the idea of stretch goals. I mean, I actually thought it wanted to see how hard it was to get a PhD, and found out. You talk about a lot of things that I think are really important in your book, you write about, I should say, and you also have emulated a lot of the things in what you've done outside of just the T.W. Lewis company, because of your different, I mean, you were former chairman of the Arizona chapter of the YPO and member of the World President's Organization and CEO International. And you like you mentioned, you and your wife have had all this philanthropy and things that you do with the T.W. Lewis Foundation. You support higher education, children's family, that type of thing. What made you pick the type of philanthropy you chose?
Well, I think it really goes back, I think, to your core values again, or your most values and your core values and your family history and your life story, really. Most philanthropy, to be authentic, we all have had things that happened to us or things we've experienced that made us want to help others who might have that problem, and the first area we support is called children and families in need. And when I was a kid, my family was from Eastern Kentucky, and we'd go up there a lot, and it's an incredibly poor place. And I saw a lot of people, and I had a lot of friends that lived in those kind of families. And I saw how tough a world they came from and how bad it was. And so I kind of had a heart for people that were at the bottom of our society. They're good people. I mean, I knew a lot of them. And in Eastern Kentucky, they're just good people, but they were dirt poor. And then the next category is educating youth. And I look around today and I just see what a void there is about education for young people. I mean, there's no religious training. There's no character. There's little character development, or it's been redefined. And so I think trying to make a difference there with educating young people to help them develop the kind of values and morality and character that it takes to be successful. That, the first chapter or the first block in my pyramid for success is personal character. Without that, nothing else matters.
Right.
And then the second block is hard work. And those are the two big blocks. Mm-hmm. Those are the two blocks at the bottom of the pyramid right there, the personal character and hard work. So, but the philanthropy comes from your life story, I would say.
Well, and as I look at the pyramid, you go on to goal setting, self-awareness, helping others. And I'm looking at some of these other areas you touch on. And you've obviously, it was really kind of interesting when I found out you wrote a book, because I think of you as a home builder and different things that you do. And I'm thinking, well, this is going to be interesting. I'm looking forward to that. And you know, I noticed that Doug Ducey, our governor, wrote the foreword of your mm-hmm. book. And before we were on the air, we were talking a little about philanthropy and where proceeds and different things are going. Now, tell me about this book. What made you want to write it, and a little bit more on that background?
Well, again, we have three sons. They're all good young men. And then they went away to college, and then they kind of went their own ways, really, which is all good. One of them still lives here in town now. But then my wife and I had this scholarship program, and from 2002 through 2016, we interviewed all these high school kids. And at first, you know, they were just like our sons, which they were just bright-eyed, optimistic, solid young kids that you love to talk to. But then I could, over the next 15 years, I could see something changing. And they were starting to talk more about finding their passion and doing what they love, and what are you going to major in? What they would have already decided and were dead set on it, not open. But it just seemed like they were they were getting a lot of bad advice, and they were acting on it. And you know, and then I looked at myself and I thought, wow, you know, look what I've done. It's pretty good. I think there's a model here that other people could learn from. And that would dispel a lot of these myths that so many young people are accepting today, like, you know, follow your passion, do what you love, live your dream, 30's the new 20, work harder. It's like, man, are you crazy? This is serious, because it's kind of funny, but it's really not funny, because if you go down that road and you're a 22-year-old coming out of college, and you believe all that, and then you wake up and you're 35 and you're in your fifth job and you're going nowhere and you don't know who you are, it's really getting close to being too late to turn that around. You know, I mean, you have to build. And an author and a lady that I've gotten to know and like, Meg Jay, wrote the book The Defining Decade, and that's a great book. It basically just makes the case that your 20s are your defining decade. If you don't, and that's why you have to get out and hustle and learn and fail and make mistakes. And that's a time in your life when you can afford to make mistakes and afford to fail. And then the lessons you learn from those failures are going to set you up for your successes in your 30s and 40s and 50s. But that's why I wrote this book is to put a message out there that is not being addressed. And one more thing I'll say about that is that I've read, I'll call it, all of the success books from Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People, to Stephen Covey, to Outliers, to Grit, to all the rest of them. And none of them talk about decision-making, risk-taking, self-awareness, and personal character. Really, and those are the bedrocks of successful people. And so I thought I had some thoughts that had not yet been expressed, and I felt like I could express them.
Well, you touch on things that are so important. If you know, you look at, like, we started off with self-awareness and some of those things which tie into emotional intelligence and some of the things that we've seen a lot of research to show that they're so important for leaders. And I think that there's just different words in terms, even when we talked about curiosity, how we look at it, it could be a little bit different perception of what we're trying to do. But we're all talking about being successful and finding meaning and purpose and that wisdom that, as you know, one of the good things about getting older, you look back and you go, wow, I had that experience and this experience, and this has really molded me to what, you know, I've decided for my life. And I think that that's why we're going to see a lot more mentorship opportunities for in the next mm-hmm. decade. I hear that word coming up quite a bit, and I see this as a kind of mentoring opportunity for people who want to read your book. And I think that a lot of people can gain a lot of wisdom from it. If they're looking to follow you and see what you're working on, is this your last book or only book or what? What's next?
Well, I'm still in recovery mode.
Isn't
from my
it fun? Oh, I know. But, it's so
hard. You know, we're doing some marketing of it, but I wouldn't be surprised if I do a sequel. But right now, I'm not ready to think about that. But, you know, I want to say another thing. Mm-hmm. So, and I touch on this in the book, but you talked about mentoring. Mm-hmm. I never had a mentor, okay? But what I did have, I really have a different name for it. I had lots and lots of role models. And here's the difference. And I might be wrong on this, but a mentor, if you look it up in the dictionary, is like a teacher. Okay, so you go to the mentor and they teach you what to do. Okay, well, I never had that. Mm-hmm. Okay, I was more self-motivated, but I was watching. I picked my teachers and they became my role models. And some of them I worked for, and some I'd never met. But they were the kind of people that I wanted to emulate, right? Maybe business leaders or fathers or whatever. And so I watched other people and I saw people that I didn't want to be like, and then I saw people that I did want to be like, and those became my role models. And so I tried to copy them, if you will. And so I tried to develop habits that I learned from other people, but they didn't even know it. I mean, they were not, it was my job to learn, not theirs. It was not their job to teach me. It was my job to learn. And that's the difference I had between being a role model and being a mentor.
Well, I think we can learn from so many different people. And I think, you know, the good thing is in this day and age, there's so much you can get online. There's so much you can get, you know, and it's hard to know what's really the best advice. Like you said, you got to be careful about bad advice. But I think this has great advice. And I think a lot of people want to know how they can get your book, follow you, find out more. Is there something you'd like to share as a website or other social media type
thing? Yeah. You bet. We have our own. It's on Amazon and in bookstores in the country. We also have our own book site called solidgroundbook.com, which is a good little summary and has some information and a lot of the quotes and things there. A few of the highlights of the book. And then we're also on social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, Solid Ground Foundation for Winning and Working in Life. So check it out. It's a good book. It's got a lot of principles in there. It's really about trying to help each of us become the best we can be. And I think that's something we all need to do and want to do.
Well, and on the website, we were talking about pyramids and different aspects of myths versus reality. And you have a lot of that great information right there, and I hope a lot of people check it out. It was really fun having you on the show, Tom. I know we met for 30 seconds, I don't know, 20, 30 years ago. It's just so nice to finally have a chance to chat.
Yeah, well, listen, I appreciate it. It was fun talking with you, and this an hour has gone by very quickly. But anyway, I think I'll mail a copy of this book to your office.
Well, that's really nice of you. I'll give you all that information when we get off the air, because I love to see. I have the PDF, but I'm looking forward to having a physical copy. Let's take a break here, and we'll be back right after this message.
Do you know someone who might benefit from taking the Curiosity Code Index assessment? The CCI is the first and only assessment that determines the factors that inhibit curiosity. It's simple. If you recommend the assessment to someone else, you can receive 20% of the purchase price that they pay when they take the CCI through the link provided by you. To obtain the link and become an affiliate, please go to drdianehamilton.com/affiliate.
Well, I'd really like to thank Tom for being my guest today. We get so many great guests on this show. If you've missed any past episodes, you can go to drdianehamilton.com and find some of them. I know we have more than 500 shows. There's a lot, but there's so much great content. And if you want to read them instead of listen to them, you can go to the blog on the site. We're also on so many different radio stations and everywhere podcasts practically are played. So, I mean, you can find us everywhere. But hope you enjoyed today's episode, and I hope you check out the next episode of Take the Lead Radio. You've been listening to Take the Lead with Dr. Diane Hamilton on C-Suite Radio.